Mr. Chairman, dear colleagues, I'm a hybrid between a hepatologist and a digestive oncologist, so I don't know whether it is an advantage. So in my talk, I will focus on the BCLC and ESMO guidelines, the pathology of early HCC, how it really determines our decision-making in this difficult jungle of local regional treatments, the power and the weaknesses of local ablation, and then, of course, I will touch also transarterial therapy. When we have the Barcelona system, it's important because the bottom line of this system shows clearly the survival that can be expected with the best treatment in the best selected patient for a given patient. And so this is really the framework for all the other guidelines that are in place. You can criticize, but at the end of the day, the survival is there. And the decision-making process can be, and of course, there is an accompanying text with the BCLC guidelines, so it makes no sense to look to an algorithm without looking and discussing the evidence behind it. And the same has been done, of course, by the ESMO guidelines, and I have picked out only the early, the BCLC O or 0 versus A, BCLC B, the early stages, and you see more options than you have in the BCLC guidelines. You have, of course, the ablation, the resection, and here the TACE in the intermediate stage. I want to emphasize that in contrast with the BCLC, you also have here this resection transplant coming into an intermediate stage. And then you have the options on brachytherapy, CERT, that's also in the picture. But please refer to the accompanying table in the ESMO guidelines, where you have the standard of care and then a few options. And there are the setup of these guidelines, it's a strict methodology in ESMO, but still we make no compromise regarding the evidence. In HCC, it all starts the discussions with, is this a potential candidate for a liver transplant? No, or perhaps in the future. And this is determining the decision making. That means that the availability of organs and how your country is organized on a legal way or on the availability of organs will determine in the end also the sequence also that you will pass. When it is in Switzerland more difficult to get a liver, you have more age limits than you have in Belgium. And so this is really very important. This transplant comes into play. But of course there are some criteria that we follow. And the criteria have been liberalized in the recent years, but still these Milan criteria, these up to 7 criteria, they're into place. So when you go down, when you have macrovascular invasion, of course the story ends and there is no indication to go for transplant anymore. But these patients are cured. You can achieve a cure in a patient with 40% chance of cure in transplant, that's fantastic, but this will never be accepted by a committee to include the patient is if the chance of really having a cure is only 40%. You should at least have 70% 5-year survival and cure in HCC population. The pathology of early HCC, you can have a small lesion here as depicted in the left lobe, early stage HCC. And what's important is this background of biology. And these are excellent Japanese studies. And it clearly shows that when you have a size of a tumor of about above 3 centimeters, you have these satellites, and they can spread 3 centimeters beyond the outer margin of the tumor. So it's an illusion to think if you have a lesion of 4 centimeters, when you just ablate this lesion without taking a margin of perhaps more than 2 centimeters, you will be able to clear this region. And this is really determining all the trials and all the results of these local therapies. The differentiation status of the tumor is also determining these satellites. If you have a well-differentiated tumor, 3 centimeters, there will be less satellites than when you have a moderately or poorly differentiated. The problem is how to identify this when you just do a biopsy and then ablate. So the power and the weaknesses of local ablation, they come to this factor, And there is no single physician who will change that, no single interventional radiologist. You cannot change the biology. So you can control the local lesion, but you will face distant recurrence in not all patients, about 80%. And to really have a disease-free survival, well, even with small lesions, you risk to have new lesions coming up. You have nice survival data in this large series of patients who were subjected to local ablation, but it's also depending, as has been discussed before, by the liver function. So liver functions comes into play, and in addition, the size of the lesions. We use ablation, and I talk now about radiofrequency ablation because I have most data on this therapy. Well, we have been using this when patients are within Milan criteria to really keep them on the waiting list, and we really know that this is effective. We can prevent the lesions from growing. There have been some debate last year, in the recent years, and now it's closed. Percutaneous ethanol injection in lesions versus RFA. There have been some randomized controlled trials that clearly show that both modalities are even effective. But you have more local tumor recurrence when you inject ethanol, and the survival at 4 years is also better when you use RFA. There have been meta-analysis done, and we are convinced that injecting ethanol, and you have to repeat this more than ablation, is far less effective, although it may be much cheaper, and so it depends on your local environment, on the applicability of treatments and so on, availability. It's much cheaper to inject ethanol, but only in lesions less than 2 centimeters, it's equally effective. If you go above 2 centimeters, ablation by radiofrequency or destruction by radiofrequency will have a benefit. There has been some discussion, puncturing an HCC, what is the risk of seeding? It's not zero, and it all depends on the experience of the person who performs the biopsy, the location of the tumor, the fact that you may use multiple sessions, multiple probe placements. There is a non-negligible risk of seeding, and I think this should all be communicated to the patient. There are several techniques that are available, and for cryoablation and to get out the frozen ball, it's difficult. There are less clinical data, and irreversible electroporation may have some theoretical benefits, but we lack clinical data to really have this now a standard of care for patients with HCC and small lesions. Radiofrequency ablation can be applied in 2 ways. You can have it immediately in the tumor, where you puncture the tumor, but you can also place the probes around the tumor in a no-touch fashion. I will come to this later. Microwave ablation is now more and more getting into the picture. And in the device world, it's incredible how fast a new device is really entering into our surgeries. So it's impressive. And there has been now a well-designed randomized controlled trial that clearly showed that from the point of efficacy or from the point of side effects, it's equally effective. So microwave ablation is clearly similarly effective. Considering the new RFA techniques, so we have this no-touch RFA technique. You put the needles alongside the tumor, in contrast with the, and you have a different way of heat exposure to the tumors. There have been some analysis, these are in fact not randomized controlled trials, where you can clearly see that the global failure of ablation is in fact you have more failure when you do the monopolar than the bipolar, and this has been the subject now of a randomized controlled trial that is finished, and we will have these results very soon. This is an interesting approach of improving, in fact, the benefit of the potential of ablation. You give IV an injection of liposomal doxorubicin, is thermosensitive, so patient gets an injection. It's hypothesized that the tumor is really capturing this liposomal doxorubicin. You have to apply the heat, and then the doxorubicin is really expanded into the tumor. There has been a previous phase 3 study that is completely negative, but there is a subgroup that clearly showed that you have to apply the heat for more than 45 minutes unless you have no effect. So this is now tested in this trial, and Riccardo Lencioni announced at the EASL meeting earlier this year that the results would be available very soon. What about external beam radiotherapy? I have to say this is a disappointing story. You have some series that clearly show the power of the technique. But when you look at this observational propensity score weight analysis from the National Cancer Institute, there seems to be, in fact, no real benefit, and even RFA seems to do better. So I know it's in the ESMO guidelines somewhere, SBRT, for those patients who are not good candidates for ablation. It's an option, but the evidence to really put this in first line as an alternative to RFA is really not there. We know, and you know, that there is no benefit for sorafenib following resection or local ablation. Well-conducted study, good identification of patients at risk, nice stratification, study completely negative. There is now an interest, and these studies have started, both for nivolumab and pembrolizumab, to really explore adjuvant treatment with immunotherapy in this field. I have to say, and I have no time to go in details, but there are mouse models of NASH and HCC, and if you give immunotherapy, you even see progression, faster recurrence in these mouse models. This has been presented also at EASL earlier this year, so we have to be very careful when we really use immunotherapy in adjuvant setting in a liver disease. So these trials are very important, and the results may be quite unsuspected. Of course, we will see this in a few years. Then the issue on transarterial therapy. Very popular. It has a prominent place, transarterial chemoembolization in the guidelines. No discussion about that. And you can achieve very nice survival. We know from detailed correlation studies of pathology following chemoembolization that you have to apply this technique in lesions that are vascularized. So the lesion needs to have a certain size and a certain arterialization before you can apply the technique. But in addition, when you apply a super selective therapy, so the local treatment of HCCs, this is in fact not appropriate. You have to apply super selective way, and the new techniques with the cone beam CT in the interventional radiology theater are really essential to target the lesions very specifically. There has been some huge interest in these beads, drug-eluting beads, and to make a long story short, the only and a very important advantage of this drug is that you avoid the big peak that you will see following classical taste of doxorubicin systemically. So you have less alopecia and you have less mucositis, and at the patient level, this is really very important. But at the end of the day, for the results, the responses, disease control, survival, it makes in fact no difference. When to stop taste? There has been some attitude in some centers to keep on doing TACE, even if you have no response. And we know that achieving a complete response in terms of loss of vascularization, induction of necrosis, it makes a difference when you have a complete response, a partial response, versus stable disease or progression. The aim should be that you adapt your response criteria and the way you judge the effectiveness of your therapy according to the mode of action of your therapy. You want to induce necrosis, and you have to see this on imaging. We have done some work, and we could show and give some evidence that just looking to M-resist and a loss of vascularization is probably not enough. It's not because your tumor becomes necrotic that you are sure that there are no viable cells. And diffusion-weighted imaging, as shown here on this is a lesion that is based on resist stable disease, based on M-resist showing a partial response, but when you look to the ADC map, you have still a nice signal that's showing active viable tumor. And this is also a patient who has a very short progression-free survival. So there are no techniques in MRI. I know it's difficult and not well adopted and so on, but there are ways to look into these lesions much more carefully than we did before. What about the issue of combining TACE RFA versus RFA alone, a randomized controlled trial that was done in the East? I personally think there was a benefit for the combination, but it was a quite exotic type of TACE, combining IV chemo and complex TACE 2 weeks later RFA. The best comparison, in my opinion, would have been to do TACE as a control and TACE plus RFA in the experimental arm, because I personally am not convinced that this is something that will, it's not used in clinical practice in all centers. It's somewhere in the evidence, in the guidelines, but of course this is not a blinded therapy also to assess response and so on. So I don't think this is, at this stage, standard of care. What about TACE and sorafenib? There are some issues that we know following TACE, you have an upregulation of angiogenic factors. This has been tried to ameliorate the results with sorafenib and other angiogenic drugs, and there are sufficient amount of evidence now to say that there is no benefit of combining TACE with sorafenib. Other systemic therapies, brivanib, orantinib, they all were negative. What is the most important thing is that you look to the placebo arm, and it's quite consistent that in the placebo arm with TACE, you have survivals of 26 to 32 months. So this really confirms the long-time survival of TACE in the patients with intermediate stage HCC. It's very consistent. What about the future? Nice design of TACE combined with immunological agents, durvalumab, bevacizumab, combination with angiogenic agents, and these are studies that now are going on. What about radioembolization? This is a very important registry, the ENRI registry, that has been done across experienced centers in Europe, huge experience in radioembolization. And they could, based on their analysis, at least suspect that the outcome of patients with Child-Pugh A BCLC-C or even some patients with BCLC-B following TACE, that they could at least have the same benefit in survival as sorafenib based on a cross-trial comparison. And this formed the basis for several randomized controlled trials of radioembolization versus sorafenib. And as a matter of evidence and looking to confidence, I like these slides that were put up by Lovett and other colleagues. It gives you a kind of nice visual impression where you are. You have the hazard ratio, the one for superiority studies, the 1.08 for non-inferiority studies, and you can clearly show, see here, that for the sorafenib and the SARA trial, you have these wide confidence intervals. And this means really you may have a similar outcome for these patients in survival, but according to strict statistical rules, these trials were not designed to show non-inferiority. And so as such, I have to agree with the chairman about evidence. There is insufficient evidence that you can say that these modalities indeed are non-inferior to sorafenib. And the same, of course, when you are as rigid for radioembolization, you should perhaps also be as rigid for immuno-oncology agents. There may be subgroups of patients who benefit from radioembolization. We don't really know who these are. And we know that non-cirrhotics with HCC may behave better than cirrhotics for radioembolization. These are issues that can come up in later studies. The EASL has put another graph of all the evidence and all the therapies that we have in HCC clearly on a graph. And I point your attention that yttrium-90 radiation, you have a high level of evidence not to use this in very advanced HCC. But then you see this yttrium in BCLC-B, it's really at the decision point. At the cutoff point, BCLC-B, it's unsure what. And why is that? Because there are some interesting data, randomized phase 2 studies, that compared SERT and TACE. And we know that we will need many thousand patients, indeed, to show a difference between SERT and TACE. But when you look to a very early group, patients with stage A BCLC, and most of these patients were on the waiting list for transplant, what you can appreciate is that SERT and TACE can induce responses, But more interestingly, when you have a response by radioembolization, it seems to be better than the response by conventional TACE. In the end, for survival, it did not make a difference, but using this modality as a bridge for transplant may be an option. So in conclusion, Mr. Chairman, RFA or microwave ablation is the standard of care for BCLC early stages in patients not fit for surgery, or they are really representing an alternative to resection in BCLC, so the very early stage. Selective TACE is recommended for selected patients with BCLC-B. Good performance status, normal liver function, no ascites, and when you really adapt and when you really stick to this criteria, you can have survivals above 2.5 years. And I have to say that the subgroup of patients benefiting from radioembolization really needs to be defined better. And with that, I close my presentation.